thanks.
Awesome.
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for your patience. Welcome to the Senate's Committee on Investigations and Government Operations. This may or may not be our last committee meeting, so I want to thank the members who are here, and I'll thank the members who are on their way for their participation and making this a successful year so far in the committee. We have a couple of nominees before we get to the bills on the agenda, and we're going to flip the order of the nominees. So first with us here today is Michael Schmidt, who is the governor's nominee to be commissioner of the Department of Taxation and Finance. He's the acting commissioner right now. I had the pleasure to meet with him a couple of weeks ago. We had a it was really my pleasure meeting you. You're clearly very qualified. I want to thank the governor for this nomination, but I felt it was important for you and the other nominee to be here to answer any questions that community members may have, and really to make your case. So welcome, and I thank you for being here again.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Senator Skoufis, members of the committee. It's great to be here, and thank you for giving me this opportunity. I really am honored to be the governor's nominee for the commissioner of the Department of Taxation and Finance. I'm a native New Yorker. I grew up in Riverdale in the Bronx. My wife is from Corning in the Southern Tier, but between the two of us, we have pretty good coverage of the state. I'm a lawyer by training, but I've spent most of my career in government public policy. I worked first in an investment role for a university endowment, but after that I joined the Treasury Department as a non-political appointee. I worked on financial regulatory reforms in the wake of the financial crisis in 2008. I served as an economic policy advisor to Hillary Clinton. I worked on a range of economic policy issues in that capacity, and then joined New York State in 2017. So I've had the privilege of working in state government for the last 2 years. My first role in the governor's office was as the deputy secretary for economic development, where I oversaw 12 state agencies and authority, Homes and Community Renewal, ESD, Department of State, and of course, most importantly, the Department of Tax and Finance. I then took on a role as senior economic advisor to the governor, where I worked really focused on tax policy issues, and in particular the response of the state to the federal tax legislation enacted at the end of 2017. As you know, in the budget, in last year's budget, we enacted a broad series of reforms in response to those changes, including decoupling reforms that save taxpayers roughly $1.5 billion every year going forward. So I mentioned that in part because I've had the privilege of working very closely with the tax department for the last couple of years. And I can say it's an outstanding agency, an outstanding group of people, and I feel really fortunate to be joining their ranks. They have a really great reputation. If you talk to other tax administrators, not just around the country, but really around the world, and I think it's a hard-earned reputation for administering our tax code with efficiency and with integrity and independence and fairness. And so really, as commissioner, I do see that as my job first and foremost is to administer the laws that you pass in a efficient and fair way. And I'm really excited for that opportunity, and I thank you for considering my nomination.
Thank you. Any questions?
I have one question, actually. Yeah. Nice to see you.
Good to see you.
What is your position on the agency's approach or ability to weigh in on the legislation that the legislature is taking, especially as it relates to the purview of your specific agency? Yeah. And how frequent do you think that the agency can weigh in, or what ways do you think that the agency and the legislature can work together?
Yep.
So that we don't come to a point in time where we have these bills and we have to do chapter amendments and it's just a real delay.
Yep.
On our end and also on getting to the governor's desk.
Yeah, so I think for the executive, obviously the governor, the department, the division of the budget, they're setting the policy agenda. They and that includes, with respect to the budget, the kind of major revenue initiatives. I think the tax department has an important role, obviously, in playing an advisory capacity in that in that function. And also, I think, to the extent that legislation is moving forward, to make sure that from a technical standpoint, it is working appropriately. We have a really strong team of lawyers in the department, as well as policy professionals, and so I do think it's important that as legislation moves forward, that we have a role in kind of informing that legislation. And certainly that's a role that I would take seriously as a commissioner.
That's great. So you would be willing to put forward program bills at the request of the legislature or even on your own initiative?
What I would say is that we will, working with the governor's office, be willing to obviously put forward program bills that we think advance the interests of the department.
Sure. And then separately from the program bills, if there are questions that the legislature has as it relates to legislation that's being drafted or the legislation that's already been drafted, would the agency be willing to work with the legislators on a regular basis? I think that we could do probably a better job across branches of working together. And I think that this is one of the areas where we have to be very careful because it's such a high level of expertise.
Yep.
So I think that we could benefit from what you have and then vice versa. So I would love to see that happen.
I
think it's a better way to
do
government when we all work together.
Okay, great.
I would second what Senator Biagi says, and I'll reiterate something I brought up when we had met a couple of weeks ago, which is, and I appreciate your response, that there's going to be a focus on making sure that the transition to the, if you want to call it the new STAR program, is as seamless as possible. There are a lot of changes that were enacted in this year's budget, some of which cause consternation for some of us, especially those of us who lived through the first iteration of changes and saw that there was quite a bit of disruption.
Yeah.
And the property tax freeze checks, which were delayed a number of years ago, we got inundated with calls as legislators. And so I don't know if you want to speak to it at all, but please do focus if and when you're appointed to make sure that the new changes cause as little disruption as possible.
Absolutely. I think that's critically important, and I'm committed not only to trying to administer those changes as efficiently as possible, but to make sure that you all have the information that you need to deal with your constituents who might have questions or concerns about how the program is working. So this is Matt Pinello. He's the Director of Governmental Affairs. He will be charged with that, but I also personally am very committed to make sure that information. So, among other things, we'll be circulating a fact sheet to you all very soon that explains exactly what we're doing. Copies of letters that taxpayers will be receiving, so you know how to associate that letters with the actions they might need to take.
Okay.
Mr. Schmidt, thank you for putting yourself forward for this important position, and I echo what my colleagues have expressed interest in. And I just wanted to really thank the agency for the expertise on the local level. We've worked with some great people in the Department of Taxation and Finance. My office has. We've done some great outreach programs, and I hope that continues. We've done these property tax seminars. There's so many questions from the exemptions that you're entitled to that you can get. What do you think are really the greatest areas that you're looking to improve upon in the Department of Taxation and Finance?
Well, I think there are kind of two core pillars, if you want to kind of categorize it. The first is really on the efficient collection of revenue. So how do we make sure that people who owe taxes are paying it? And how are we leveraging the most modern toolkit sets like data analytics to, for example, decide who we should audit and who we should leave alone and how long should we be spending on those audits. I think there is a lot of opportunity to make sure that we are doing everything we can to provide the state with the resources it needs to provide the services and investments that our residents expect. But I think the other side of that coin is taxpayer services and making sure that people's interactions with the tax department are modern and understandable and clear and coherent. And I think, there are probably times where the tax department meets that objectives, and there are probably times where currently we don't. So that's always going to be a work in progress. It's something, one thing the governor has said in the past is that when you think about when people interact with their government, they go to the DMV and they pay their taxes. And if they live downstate, maybe they take the subway. So if kind of part of our project here is giving people faith that their government can be a force for good, I think it's really important that the tax department play an active role in trying to make those interactions as positive as possible.
Okay. And what do you think are some of the biggest challenges right now in the Department of Taxation?
So I would say a couple things. One is obviously from a policy perspective, there's state and local tax deductibility, which is something that I think obviously the governor has been very forceful on, and is something we have to watch very closely. You know, from an operations and administrative perspective, I think I've only been at the department for a couple months, kind of really in the weeds on it. But I think with any large institution, there's a challenge associated with trying to be nimble and responsive to challenges, while also operating in the context of existing systems. And so I think constantly thinking, being thoughtful about, you know, how we're updating our technological capacity, and how we can kind of harness the systems we have in place to be as constructive and possible as possible for taxpayers and important voters.
Okay.
Great.
Thank you.
All good? Okay.
Thank you
very much for your time. Yeah.
Thanks for your time. Great.
Thank you. Thank you.
How are you?
Not yet, we need to vote on this.
Is he constituent or resident?
No, I'm constituent.
Oh, no, okay.
Is it from the years?
I'm from our CPA and a resident.
I'm not on the committee, I just suggested that.
Welcome to China. Any further conversation, or are we good to vote?
Good.
Okay. On favor of moving the nomination of Michael Schmidt as Commissioner of the Department of Taxation and Finance.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. Nomination's moved. We can get Ms. Fernandez. Yeah. Hey, welcome. We're down this way. Thank you again.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, welcome. So with us here is Acting Commissioner of the Division of Human Rights, Angela Fernandez, seeking to be Commissioner. Stripped down the acting from her title. Welcome. We appreciate you being here at the request of the committee. Just as the previous nominee, if you can tell us a little bit about yourself, why you want to be the commissioner. I know some of us had questions. There was, as I'm sure you're well aware, there was a hearing just last week, a second hearing on sexual harassment in the workplace. And the committee felt it was important you'd be here. The deputies that were there didn't feel they had the authority to answer some questions, and so we hope that you will be able to answer those questions.
Wonderful.
Thank you for being
here. Well, thank you very much. I really appreciate your inviting me here. If it's okay with you, I'd like to read my opening remarks. Good afternoon, members of the Senate Investigations and Government Operations Committee. I'm the Acting Commissioner of the New York State Division of Human Rights, and it is a great honor to be here before you. My mother is from the Dominican Republic, and my father is from the south of Spain. Both were raised under repressive dictatorships before they migrated to the United States. Growing up as the daughter of immigrants, my parents' experience has colored my understanding of power and its potential abuses. Identifying ways to expose and stop those abuses has been a driving force in the professional path that I have chosen. Upon graduating from Columbia University School of Law, I decided to center my work within the experiences of marginalized and oppressed communities to bring power and dignity to those who are told day in and day out that they are not deserving of both. I began my legal career in the field of human rights, investigating labor law violations with the Center of Human Rights Legal Aid in Cairo, Egypt. While there, I developed a process so that the organization could file international human rights claims against the Egyptian government for violating labor laws. As an education advocate, I created and implemented the first of its kind women's studies program at Rikers Island Correctional Facility for female detainees. Under my leadership, the Northern Manhattan Coalition for Immigrant Rights spearheaded innovative and collaborative initiatives that translated into policy wins which have benefited all New Yorkers. As an author reporter for the ABC News, World News Tonight, Good Morning America, and Nightline, I push boundaries to uplift stories of those who suffered as a result of poor public policy. My government experience includes serving on the New York City Civilian Complaint Review Board, working as a staffer for the U.S. Senator Bill Bradley, and as District Chief of Staff for Congressman Jose Serrano. If confirmed as Commissioner of the Division of Human Rights, I will bring to the position all of these collective experiences, as well as my long track record of executing complicated projects to address the needs of underrepresented communities. The New York State Division of Human Rights is responsible for investigating, prosecuting, and adjudicating complaints of discrimination brought under New York human rights law, which is the oldest state-level anti-discrimination provision in the country. The federal government's present retreat of robust anti-discrimination enforcement means that New Yorkers have fewer places to turn to for protection and redress from discrimination. As a result, there are those who feel emboldened to abuse and discriminate against people based on their race, gender, national origin, religion, sexual orientation, gender identity, disability, or any of the other protected classes established under the human rights law. In light of this, the work of the Division of Human Rights has never been more important. Given that the New York State human rights law is not only the oldest in the country, it is also one of the most expansive. As a result, the division is uniquely positioned to fill the vacuum created by the federal government's retreat. I am fully confident that the Division of Human Rights, under my leadership, will not only continue the important work it has done throughout its existence, but it will also substantially increase its efforts to ensure that all New Yorkers are protected against discrimination, harassment, and bigotry. Thank you.
You want to kick it off, Senator?
Yes, Blaine? I'd love to. I'm very happy to see you here today. We missed you at the hearing on Friday. I really wish that you had been there. I think I would love to start with some of your experience that you touched on, which is incredibly impressive and very promising, I think, for the state of New York, which has a history of lack of accountability and a lack of of being a place where people feel that they're safe, where people feel that their issues are taken seriously, where they feel like they're being heard. And I do think that conversation here is an important one because this is a critical moment. As you know, I'll just take it from the point of sexual harassment, it's an epidemic, not only in the state of New York, but in the country, and quite frankly, in the world. And so you mentioned that your family had lived under a dictatorship, which is awful, has lived through lots of oppression, and also that when you were in Cairo, you were responsible for receiving complaints for human rights violations, international human rights violations, which is incredibly serious and very sensitive and risky for people who come forward and also for the people who are handling those cases. If you can, you know, there's an analogous situation here between what you've done and also what's going on here, and I think that we have every obligation to get this right. We can't get this wrong. And if we take seriously what's going on, we have to make sure that that's the case. So I would really love to hear first question is, how within, you know, your work in Cairo and your work within the many different systems that you expressed, were you able to really hold accountable the systems that you were working in? Because that's a huge part of it. Mm-hmm. And how comfortable are you with that? Mm-hmm. And then what is your vision for taking away the opaque and Byzantine layers that are in the Division of Human Rights and how people who come forward feel or will feel that their claims and cases will be taken seriously.
Absolutely. I'm really happy that you asked that question. And first, I want to open up and say that I, as Commissioner, am looking forward to working with all of you. You are all in a very unique position because you represent districts. I come from the grassroots, and that is where it's at. And so we are going to learn from you what you're hearing from your constituents on what's happening on the ground. So that is one of the ways in which I'm looking forward to partnering with you. I'll take one example on your first question. When I worked for ABC News, one of the projects that I was tasked with was partnering with the Innocence Project. And this is quite some time ago. This is when the Innocence Project was just starting. And if you're familiar with the Innocence Project, okay. So we joined forces to take our investigatory powers as journalists and investigate death penalty cases in Texas and in Louisiana. What we uncovered was horrific. This was all under, at that time, Governor Bush's period. And as we know, I think about 180 people were executed. When we looked at those cases and saw that so many due process violations had occurred, to be able to take that information, which took about a year to collect, process it with the Innocence Project. Again, the partnership with someone who's on the ground actually doing the work, something that I took very seriously and that our investigative unit took seriously. We were then able to broadcast this on mainstream news. We were able to broadcast this on ABC News. Peter Jennings was alive at the time. I mean, this was very impactful, and I like to think that it contributed to the beginning of the sea change that has occurred over the last 15 years around how people view the death penalty. Mm-hmm. So that's one example.
Do you think that if you were working within the government in Texas and you came across these violations, that you would have been comfortable enough to bring them to light? And if so, how would you have gone about that? Because I think one of the things that I'm getting at here is that just from so much of the testimony that we've heard and so much of, quite frankly, the complaints, and it's not just my constituents. I think, you know, as state senators, we, of course, have an obligation to our constituents, but also to the entire state of New York as a responsibility to making every corner of the state safe. And it's just like one story after the next story after the next story of, like, this system failed me, this system failed me, this system failed me, or, like, I'm still waiting, and how long is amount of time has gone by. Mm-hmm. And to me, I mean, it's disruptive to people's lives.
Of course.
And especially, you know, to individuals who have to continue to go to work because they don't have the opportunity to go somewhere else. It's, the abuses exist, so I will just ask it perhaps in a different way, which is, if you were in Texas and you had worked in that government, what would have been the way in which you would have gone about raising it? Because it's more challenging, even within our system, within the legislature. If we identify something along the way, it's not easy to bring light to it for many different reasons. But I would like to think of these issues, especially any violations against human beings, as post-political. Like, we're not talking about politics anymore.
That's right.
When people are in harm's way. Mm-hmm. And so that's the seriousness with which, excuse me, I take this, because I feel an incredible obligation to protect all of the individuals, male and female, who come forward.
No, absolutely. I mean, I think, have I ever been to Texas? I don't think I've actually been to Texas. So I did a lot of the research from here. If I were there, the most important thing would be to identify what are the levers that one can push that would actually hold people accountable. Mm-hmm. So when there were due process violations happening from the prosecutorial side in these death penalty cases, who or what oversees the prosecutors to be able to hold them accountable for what they are doing? Or is it holding accountable judges? Or is it holding accountable another entity? But to take very seriously, and the way that I see government, and having been on the grassroots, running a grassroots immigrants' rights organization for 10 years, pre-Trump, when no one wanted to hear what we were saying, because we were ringing the alarm bells before Trump got elected. Trump came into power, and the system was in place to be able to do what's happening. Coming with having to be incredibly resourceful with very few resources, coming into government, I see a tremendous amount of potential on how to pull the certain levers to be able to ensure that we are doing the best for all New Yorkers.
Mm-hmm. So I just want to make very clear that I understand. Are you comfortable if you know, taking on this role? I know you're the acting commissioner, but fully embracing this role, not to say that you haven't already done that, but fully embracing this role, are you comfortable when you see gaps within this agency that are negligent or that really need to be fulfilled? Are you comfortable not only raising awareness around that internally, but then also, you know, asking for help from the legislature of, you know, we need a law to protect this because this is beyond the bounds of what I can do? Or, like, are you comfortable with that, and do you see that as the pathway forward for one of the ways to be successful here?
Mm-hmm. Sure. So, if I understand correctly, you're asking about legislation or potential ideas around legislation.
And also, just if you see something, it's not only legislation, but if you see something in the agency that you know is not right, are you comfortable speaking up about that? And also, then, if there's a legislative fix there, are you comfortable then reaching out to us and saying, we need legislation on this specific issue?
Now, you know, the primary goal here is to ensure that the agency is doing right by New Yorkers. If there is something, and I'm not sure what you mean exactly, something not happening in the agency. But, I mean, as the commissioner, I have a responsibility to ensure that the agency is run efficiently, mm-hmm. And that it is following its mission, and that it is executing its mission. I will absolutely ensure that if something needs to be improved upon, I will take the necessary steps to do that. And, you know, each, if there's an area that needs to be improved upon, it's going to have a different solution. It really depends on what the issue is. But I took a small, sleepy grassroots organization that was $400,000 budget and quadrupled the budget within 10 years in something that everyone said, there's no way that you can get funding for immigration. This is before Trump got elected. It wasn't in my bio here, but I was the president of the Dominican Day Parade. I was elected president of the Dominican Day Parade to turn it around. It had been run for 20 years by one person, and the person was not running it the way it was supposed to be run. I took it and turned it around and brought it open book respectability. I have a track record of doing that. Now, I don't think that the Division of Human Rights is in that position. I don't think that it needs to undergo a huge turnaround. I think that one of the things that we are going to do is provide more outreach and more education, public education. And I come from a background of providing public education to what's called hard-to-reach populations. And hard-to-reach populations are populations that are marginalized and that are outside of the system. And this is immigrants, people of color, people who are disabled, people who are seniors, and having had a track record of developing relationships with institutions that are trusted by these folks. For example, for immigrants, it's their consulate. So we would develop relationships with the consulate, come in and do public education to the consulate staff on how to take that information and transfer it over to the people that are coming into their offices, to religious institutions. We've done this before. We go, especially in the Latino community, going into beauty salons and barbershops. Our agency is going to be in there. And so that is the commitment that I have as a commissioner, to make sure that this information, which is, you know, when we look at it, it's like, oh my God, it's a lot of legalese. It's like, yeah, no. Behind this legalese are very, very straightforward, people's lives are behind this legalese. So we make sure that we translate that and make it accessible to the ordinary individual so that they can file claims.
I'm glad to hear you take it so seriously. Mm-hmm.
Do you think that severe and pervasive is the appropriate threshold for sexual harassment?
So the severe or pervasive threshold, first I would like to say that the Division of Human Rights takes a liberal interpretation of human rights law as per it is required by its terms. The severe or pervasive threshold is something that that Governor Cuomo has already proposed that needs to be changed and reduced, and we are absolutely supportive of removing that barrier of severe and pervasive.
Do you think we should adopt New York City's definition, their threshold? Or do you have a different proposal?
I can't comment on theirs. To be quite honest, I have not looked closely at their language, and it would be irresponsible of me to comment on their specific language. But we are committed to removing and diminishing that threshold.
The legislative session is about to end very soon, and there is a series of bills within a package for sexual harassment legislation to address some of the things that we've talked about, some of the gaps that we've identified from the testimony that we've heard, as well as the elimination of the severe or pervasive standard, and also to ensure that on the basis of not just harassment but discrimination, that individuals can be held to account. I would ask you to please formally weigh in on this bill before the end of the session. I know that it is almost June. On Saturday, it is June. It's important for us to understand the position of the agency, especially the agency that will be administering this law. And it's a little bit troubling to me that you don't know the New York City law as well as I would have hoped that you would. But the law that we're proposing in the legislature would be in alignment with what the standard in New York City has been for the past 10 years. And what we've heard from the Business Council is that changing the standard would be a really have a really damaging effect on business, but it is not good for business, especially the business of New York, to have individuals allowed to be harassed and discriminated against on any means. And so it's very important to myself, and I think to this body, that we hear from the Division of Human Rights as it relates to this package of legislation. So I would ask that you please, whether it's through a program bill or whatever it may be, weigh in before the end of the session, because I think that's how we do our due diligence as legislators.
Do you have any comment on some of the other bills in the package? We've talked about the severe or pervasive.
Sure. So, so as the commissioner, I need to sign orders that are recommended by the administrative law judges. It would be irresponsible for me to right now make a public comment on the slate of legislation without, well, first of all, it would be irresponsible because making a general comment could then be utilized by someone who would want to challenge an order that I've signed on based on something that I'm saying publicly, especially without having read closely the case law behind it, read closely the language, and assessed the language around the proposed bill.
Have you read the package of bills that we've put forward?
I've been here, I just finished my third week, and my priority has been in identifying and understanding how the agency works and what are the areas within the agency in which we can have the most impact.
Okay, will you read them before the end of the week so we can be able to have the position of DHR as we have about 2.5 weeks left?
So, legislative opinions of this nature are provided to, we as DHR, the commissioner, and the general counsel provides opinions to the governor's office. And so we will be looking at this legislation, other legislation, to be able to provide opinions to the governor's office.
So before this session is over.
Sorry, go ahead, please.
No, that's, I'm just trying to understand the timeline.
We will do this. I cannot promise you the timeline. To be very, you know, to be very frank and honest, I just literally started 3 weeks ago. But we take this very seriously, and we will be looking at it.
I'm just trying to understand the process, and if you could reconcile what you just said with what you said previously, which is, you know, as commissioner, you sign these orders, right? Mm-hmm. And you know, you don't want, as a commissioner, to take a position on pending legislation, the fear that it might cause a problem with these orders mm-hmm. that you have signed. But you just said that if the bill's passed, you will offer a recommendation to the governor as to whether he should presumably sign or veto
the bill. No. Not if the bill passes, no. We will provide, I see what you're saying.
Yes, you just said you would provide an opinion to the governor.
Right,
correct.
So right, absolutely, you would provide an opinion to the governor.
Why wouldn't that have the same impact on, or why do you have the same concern vis-a-vis the orders you've signed? Why will you give him an opinion but not us an opinion?
Giving an opinion in public where anyone can then take it and compromise the integrity of the agency, that's what I am concerned about. And so I'm trying to maintain the impartiality of the agency as well. Providing an opinion to the governor's counsel is a conversation that's not happening in the public, and it is a privileged conversation, and it's providing an opinion on what we see could be the potential outcome of a particular legislation, or that this a certain legislation could expand the scope of the DHR law. So I think that's where it is in two different things.
So if I may, I continue on this issue. Oftentimes, agencies, after a bill is passed, the governor's office will reach out to an agency seeking a recommendation and analysis of the bill, mm-hmm. and you know, I've seen the documents, the agency then offers a recommendation, whether to sign or veto that bill. Mm-hmm. Does that happen with DHR right now? And that information is public, so that's spoilable. I mean, we, you know, I believe the packets, the bill packets, are sent to the state archives. Anyone can get them, and so that is public information. Mm-hmm. So again, how do you reconcile offering us an opinion that may be in public here, or perhaps a conversation offline? But those documents that are sent to the governor, when they're seeking counsel about a bill, that is public information. Those are public documents.
Mm-hmm. So I want to make sure that I understand the question, because you're speaking specifically now about the governor coming to the agency, seeking an opinion from our general counsel, from myself, and then that information being archived, and someone could
go. So if we pass an environmental bill, the DEC, the governor's office will often reach out to the DEC saying, what do you think about this bill that passed? Should we sign it? Should we veto it? And they put together a document, they sent it to the governor's office, mm-hmm. and that document is spoilable and public mm-hmm. information. Mm-hmm. Does that same process happen with human rights bills, mm-hmm. number one, and number two, then how do you reconcile mm-hmm. that with what you just said before?
So, again, I started 3 weeks ago.
Sure.
I do know that the governor's office seeks our opinion on matters. It is very different from speaking publicly in front of cameras on specific legislation, and I think there is a difference between the two. I mean, you're right. Okay. An enterprising individual can go and seek this information, and then potentially, you know, use it in the way that they may want to use it. I do want to communicate. I feel that I want all of you to walk away understanding that I do want to work with all of you, and because I view all of you being in the positions of having a tremendous amount of knowledge. And I don't know if you know the term emergent strategies, but emergent strategies is that it's all here. We have it here. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. And so that's how I want to work with you. But I do also, as it's my responsibility as a commissioner, to also maintain the impartiality of the agency. Otherwise, we will lose legitimacy. And so I would hope that I could get that help from all of you in ensuring that we protect the agency so that it can do its work of investigating and prosecuting and going after people that are breaking the law.
So just to clarify, so how can we work together? What is...
I mean, I would absolutely invite being able to meet with you, meet with each of you one-on-one. I want to hear from you. I want to hear from you what your concerns are. I want to hear from you about even... you know, about how the law is being, how are we executing the law in your districts? I really want to hear about that.
So to that point, can we get a commitment from you that any bill sponsors of these, especially the 10 bills that are in this package, if they reached out to you before the end of session, would you be willing to meet with them and discuss perhaps how to make technical or substantive improvements in your eyes to the bills, offer your opinion in a meeting like that?
What I can do is have a conversation with you. I cannot give a general blanket response saying that I will be able to provide technical advice to the bills. I cannot give a broad answer to that. I can meet with you and then on a case-by-case be able to have a conversation with you.
Real quick?
Yeah, I mean, clearly you work for the governor and you would need to mm-hmm. get approval to do that sort of thing. Question on the process. The administrative law judges for Human Rights Division of Human Rights, mm-hmm. how are they, what's the process of them becoming an administrative judge? Are they appointed mm-hmm. by the governor or mm-hmm.
We put up a posting for any openings when they happen. Folks, candidates are screened for experience, for aptitude, for knowledge, and then once a recommendation is made, they're screened by key staff within the agency. Then a recommendation is made, and they go through a background check with the governor's office, and then they are hired by a DHR.
Okay.
Thank
you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Okay.
further conversation.
I just have a question, a general question. This is very broad. So the role of our state agencies is to administer the law, right? It's to create regulations, to flesh out some of the law, and to become and be subject matter experts in their specific area. So I'm a little bit confused as to an agency being impartial on issues, especially as serious and the serious nature of what human rights, the scope of human rights law. And I just want clarification as to whether an agency is actually supposed to be impartial or not. I don't know the answer, but my thought is that it's not supposed to be impartial. Do we know the answer to that? It could be a comment and it could be answered later, but I think that's a really important note here, and perhaps we have to dig up the law to see what the role of the agencies are, because they're not impartial, because if they were impartial, they wouldn't be doing their jobs. That's my thought.
And these are executive branch agencies, right?
Right.
They are part of the structure of state government, and
right.
They're appointed by the governor.
Okay.
And I don't know, Gabe, if you want to weigh in from a technical point of view.
I would say, Senator, that generally speaking, policy and the aims of policy are the job of the legislature. So in terms of saying that an agency needs to be impartial, it is not up for them to decide what our aim of policy is. It is for them to effectuate that aim as effectively as possible. The legislature, with the governor, as elected officers of the people, are the ones that determine the policy. So perhaps they may opine that doing it one way or the other may get us closer to the desired end of the policymakers, but the agencies themselves, as agencies that execute the law, generally speaking, should be doing what you, as one of the people who sets policy, wants them to be doing, as opposed to them making a decision that, the legislators were wrong.
I understand that, actually, and I understand my role fully. I have a question about, just a clarifying question about what you said. So if they identify in the course of their employment in the agency that there's a gap in the law that clearly needs to be fixed, and they raise that to our attention, that's part of it as well, because we are not in that area of the law every single day. We're not administering the law, and the creation of law and the administration of law, just like the practice of law and the actual, learning of law, are two different things, that when sometimes you apply a law, it has a very different result than what was intended. So if they see something in the way that we've written the law that's a problem, do they not have the authority to raise that to our attention?
They can submit departmental bills. Just several bills in this agenda, for example, are departmental bills, bills that the departments and agencies themselves believe are, effective changes to the changes to the law that should take effect, and then we decide if they're correcting that.
Okay, so they do play some role in policy making.
They can submit legislation to the legislature for its review.
Thank you so much.
Any other conversation? Questions? Okay. So can I get a motion to move Ms. Fernandez, I believe, to finance? Is that right?
Correct.
She goes to finance. It's Commissioner of Division of Human Rights. Motion, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Any without rec? I know Senator Jacobs is without rec. And I don't think we have any goes. Okay. She's moved to finance. All right, so for those who are able to stay, we've got a legislative calendar here. We'll move as quickly as possible. S-635.
Boom bill.
Super.
Yeah, I know.
S-635 by Senator Boyle, an act to amend the tax law in relation to granting a sales and compensating use tax exemption for toilet paper and toilet tissue sold for household use and incontinence products. This will be a referral to finance.
Okay, motion?
Motion.
Seconds? All in favor?
All right.
Bill is referred to finance. Next, S-1245.
S-1245 by Senator Carlucci, an act to amend the alcoholic beverage control law in relation to the exemption of certain parcels of land.
Motion?
Motion.
Seconds? All in favor?
Aye.
Bill is reported. Next is S-1625.
S-1625, Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the Public Officers Law in relation to enacting the Integrity in Government Act.
Okay, I'll make a motion. Second?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, bill's reported. I think we waited out Senator Jacobs on this next one. S-1659.
S-1659, Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the tax law in relation to imposing a tax related to executive compensation.
I'll make a motion. Is there a second?
Can you just take one sentence on this?
Yeah, so this is modeled after a surcharge that was put in place in Portland, in Oregon, where it's demonstrated quite a bit of success the past couple of years, whereby any CEO that makes between 100 times and 250 times the average salary of their workers, that company, their tax liability in that jurisdiction must pay a 10% surcharge. And if you're above 250 times, a 25% surcharge, with the thinking being, look, if you're a CEO, you are entitled to make as much money as you want. We live in America. It's a great country. Have at it. But in the process, we as a government should put together a framework whereby those CEOs must respect the workers that helped them make all of that money. And if you're making millions and millions of dollars as a CEO and your average salary for your workers is $25,000, $30,000, you're paying them dirt, they're on food stamps, they're in Section 8 housing, that's unacceptable to me. And so that's where this bill comes from.
It's about a sentence.
Yeah. That's a good question.
Yeah, thank you.
And this will be a referral to finance.
Any questions? Okay. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Bill's reported. Referred to finance, sorry. Next is S-1852.
S-1852, Senator Jacobs. An act to amend the Alcoholic Beverage Control Law in relation to exempting certain parcels of land from the provisions of law which generally restrict manufacturers, wholesalers, and retailers from sharing an interest in a liquor license.
Okay, I'll move the bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
The bill's reported. Next is S-3755.
S-3755 by Senator Mayer, an act to amend Chapter 507 of the laws of 2016 relating to the imposition of an occupancy tax in the village of Harrison in relation to extending the effectiveness thereof.
This is an extender. Do we have a motion?
Move the bill.
Okay, second. Aye. All in favor?
Aye.
The bill's reported. Next, S-3790.
S-3790 by Senator May, an act to amend the state law in relation to designating the tugboat Urger as the official tugboat of the state of New York.
My understanding is that this does have significance beyond the designation and that there is a local issue in Senator May's district having to do with this specific tugboat in the Erie Canal, and some folks want to remove it. This would help it remain in the Erie Canal. So do we have a motion?
Move the bill.
Okay, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. Next is S-5230.
S-5230 by Senator Salazar, an act to amend the tax law in relation to enacting the Disaster Preparedness and Emergency Planning Act relating to establishing a local sales and use tax exemption for emergency preparedness supplies.
Okay, I'll make a motion. Is there a second?
Yep,
okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. Next, S-5247.
S-5247, Senator Harkin, an act authorizing the Commissioner of General Services to convey real property in Westchester County to the County of Westchester. This will be referred to finance.
I believe we have a home rule at the desk.
We do.
Okay.
Yep.
Do you have a motion?
Motion.
And second, all in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. S-5399.
S-5399 by Senator Martinez. An act to amend the state law in relation to naming the wood frog the official amphibian of the state of New York.
There's apparently a backstory to this. This bill is at the request, on the calendar, at the request of Senator Martinez. Do we have a motion?
Motion.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. Next,
S-75.
Yeah, thank you. You were here for that one?
I understand it's not going to pass the legislation, but there is a backstory and it's a wonderful story.
Yes.
So.
Okay.
Thank you.
S-5509.
S-5509, Senator Metzger, an act to amend the Alcoholic Beverage Control Law in relation to allowing brewery supply stores to sell beer for off-premises consumption.
Okay, I'll move the bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
The bill's reported. S-5639A.
S-5639A, Senator Breslin, an act to amend the Alcoholic Beverage Control Law in relation to exempting certain parcels of land from the provisions of law which generally restrict manufacturers, wholesalers, and retailers from sharing an interest in a liquor license.
Move the bill.
Okay, move. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? Bill's reported. Next, S-5766.
S-5766, Senator Gorin, an act to amend the public officers law in relation to the residency of correction officers employed by the County of Nassau.
Okay, I'll move the bill. Second?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. S-5786.
S-5786, Senator Kaminsky, an act to establish a task force to explore the effects of cyberbullying in New York State and potential measures to address such effects.
Okay, move the bill. Second.
Aye.
Bill's reported. S-5802.
Senator Benjamin, an act to amend the public officers law in relation to the unauthorized release of sealed records.
I'll move the bill. Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. A few more. S-5922.
S-5922, Senator Salazar, an act to amend the public buildings law in relation to requiring that all single occupancy bathrooms in state-owned or operated buildings be designated as gender neutral.
It's a great bill. Passes the assembly, and hopefully it'll pass the Senate now.
Yes.
Motion.
Move.
Second.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. S-5936.
S-5936, Senator Ranzenhofer, an act to amend the public officers law in relation to the residence of the person holding the office of town superintendent of highways or town engineer of the town of Pavilion, Genesee County.
I'll move the bill. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's
Aye.
Reported. S-6007.
S-6007, Senator Skoufis, an act to amend the Alcoholic Beverage Control Law and the Public Health Law in relation to the use of biometric identity verification devices for the purchase of alcoholic beverages and tobacco products.
This is an opt-in program, just to be clear. I'll make a motion. Is there a second?
I have a question.
Sure.
About it. So can you just talk a little bit about the privacy of this information and how, just how it would be protected?
Sure. So these are, what we understand is that these devices are currently in use as an optional thing that folks can sign up with the company that maintains the biometrics, and then, for instance, TSA accepts it as a way that you can check your identity at an airport, and other places are starting to. So a user would have to decide they want to pay a fee to the biometrics company to give
it's
them
individual
their
opt-in.
Individual opt-in, and then the bill would allow a bar or a place that sells alcohol or tobacco to offer as an option that people who have enrolled in these biometric programs could validate their ID through that way rather than through the traditional driver's license. And it would simply just say yes or no, they are of age, basically.
But how would they, if they were in a bar, how would they prove that that's that? Like, what would they put their finger on something or what?
I guess there's
like types facial recognition.
Yeah, there's types of scanners.
Yeah.
But again, it's an individual opt-in. It would only work if somebody has chosen to enroll in these programs.
And what state has implemented this?
I
think Oregon or Washington has passed a similar law.
Yeah.
Got it.
But again, it's the opt-in is for the consumer.
Okay, so I just want to say one thing about this.
Sure.
One of the things that scares me about the future of technology is this facial recognition technology that China has also taken it upon themselves to use without opt-in provisions and whatever. And since we don't yet know how the information will, like, ultimately can be protected, that's something that just concerns me as just a general thing, and I think it should concern probably all of us. But this is, for an efficiency purpose, I understand what you're doing, and the fact that it's opt-in is, I think, important here. So I understand. I'm good.
Okay. Great.
Yeah.
Any other questions?
No. That's good. Yeah.
All right. I'll move the bill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Bill's reported. Two more. S-6157.
Senator Liu. An act to amend the executive law in relation to providing that there is no exemption from the requirement of non-discrimination in advertisements and inquiries for the rental of an apartment in an owner-occupied two-unit dwelling or for the rental of rooms in an owner-occupied dwelling, and that engaging in discriminatory advertising or inquiries will cause the property to no longer be exempt from full coverage by the non-discrimination provisions of the human rights law.
Your motion?
Motion.
Second. In favor? Bill's reported. Last but not least, S-6172.
Senator Martinez, an act to amend the executive law in relation to clarifying that reasonable accommodation to enable a person with a disability to use and enjoy a dwelling includes the use of an animal to alleviate the symptoms or effects of a disability.
I'll move the bill. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Bill's reported. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great day.
Senator Bianchi.